It's like, if you build it, they will come. Mm-hmm. No.
It's not that way.
No, they won't. They really won't. If you build it and then promote the hell out of it and then ask your friend to promote the hell out of it and then tweet about it and post about it, then maybe they'll think about coming.
Welcome to Modern Entrepreneur. Today we have with us Jenna McCarthy. Thank you so much for being here. She is an internationally published writer, a relationship expert, a keynote speaker, former radio personality, wannabe screenwriter, the author of more than a dozen humorous books for adults and children. Her work has appeared in more than 60 magazines, on countless websites, and in several anthologies, including the popular Chicken Soup series. Jenna's TED Talk, What You Don't Know About Marriage, has been viewed more than 4 million times around the world. In her spare time, Jenna likes to wonder what she used to do with her spare time. Thank you so much for being here.
I'm thrilled to be here. Thank you for having me.
And I just learned that you're like a local Santa Barbara person.
I am.
And so you just you spend your time writing.
I do, mostly.
And what do you do with your spare time?
I don't have spare time.
Okay.
I have children and a husband and a zoo full of animals, so not a lot of spare time.
And
so
quite a lot of books, I noticed.
A lot of books.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So how much time do you spend writing every week?
Less and less, because as you probably know, when you create any product, mm-hmm. In the world that we live in now, the creation becomes the smaller part and the marketing and promoting and the selling becomes the larger part.
Right.
So, of a work week, which could be 20 hours or 80 hours, I probably spend 25% writing.
Interesting. I think that'll probably be interesting to a lot of authors out there who imagine that it's about like writing the book and then handing it over to the magic people who make it all work out after that.
You think that, right? Mm-hmm. You do. It's like, if you build it, they will come.
Mm-hmm.
No.
It's not that way.
No, they won't. They really mm-hmm. won't. If you build it and then promote the hell out of it and then ask your friend to promote the hell out of it and then tweet about it and post about it, then maybe they'll think about coming.
Right. So it's like a normal business.
Yeah, exactly.
Awesome. So perfect, because we're here to talk about business.
Here we are.
Tell me what you figure your like unique skill set is.
I thought about this because I watched many of your videos and I truly believe my unique skill set is I am an artist mm-hmm. with a business brain.
Yeah.
And you know, you hear all the time about the starving artist, because artists like to create mm-hmm. and they tend to be introverted, which I am not, mm-hmm. and they tend to put all of their energy into the creation and then crossing their fingers and, well, I built it, why aren't they coming? But yeah. I don't want to deal with that, so I'm going to go back into my cave and continue to create.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually, not all the time, but most of the time, I get excited about the promotion part. I get excited about being able to interact with my readers and my customers and having that feedback cycle and all that kind of stuff. So, and I'm very, very conscious of the bottom line because, well, I live in Santa Barbara.
Yeah.
You know, I have an astronomical mortgage that I have to pay. Mm-hmm. Writing isn't a luxury for uh-huh. me, it's a career. So yeah. I have to have that business brain or I'd be in a trailer park in Santa Barbara.
Which wouldn't be so bad.
I know, I really wouldn't actually.
So that's interesting. So you spend 75% of your time actually like marketing the business of the work. And I think we have at Ontraport a lot of authors as customers. And I actually don't know all that much about book promotion. I've never really focused on that. I'm curious to hear, like, how similar is that, do you think, to you know, the marketing of any other business?
Sure.
And specifically, in your case, what is working for you right now?
Okay, double-edged question. Mm-hmm. Number one, I, in all honesty, this is the only business I have, but
yeah.
you know, my husband puts on sporting events. I kind of help him with his social media stuff. Mm-hmm. I have friends that I write promotional pieces for their restaurants or their clothing lines. And like I said, at the end of the day, we're all selling something.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm selling my voice. How do I do that? I tweet, mm-hmm. I guest blog, I, you know, however I can get myself in front of my potential customers.
Mm-hmm.
I almost feel like in a way what I do is easier to sell because I could just guest blog on your site
mm-hmm.
and I don't have to be writing about writing or writing about fiction or writing about anything I write about,
mm-hmm.
but I can sell my voice just through those words.
Mm-hmm.
So to that end, into the second question, mm-hmm. what I think is working is the diversity, right? So I'm a speaker,
mm-hmm.
I'm a blogger,
mm-hmm.
I'm a social media addict, I am. I'm that person who I can't even like see out of my eye and I'm already checking my Instagram and you know my Snapchat and all my feeds. So I think that integration of all those elements, mm-hmm. when I'm giving a speech at the end, I can say, hey, check out my books. On my website, I can promote my speaking engagements. Mm-hmm. In my books, I can promote my blog. And so they all sort of work, you know, synergistically to promote the other things I do.
Mm-hmm. And so, so specifically, hopefully. is there like one thing that, I mean, you know, it all is kind of like an orchestra, right? But every once in a while you have something that kind of like breaks through and is like, wow, that actually really worked. I'm going to do more of that. what is that thing?
Well, the thing that really worked was, I think this might answer a different question, but the thing that worked for me was this total accidental, I gave a TED Talk, right? Uh-huh. And I had no intention of giving a TED Talk. I knew what they were. They were for people that were not at all like me. Yeah. They were for PhDs and Jill Bolte Taylors and Al Gores and experts.
Yeah.
And so if you've ever been to a TED event, mm-hmm. you know that you have to apply just to attend it. Mm-hmm. You have to fill out this laborious, fairly application and say who you are and a little bit about yourself. So mm-hmm. I tried to be funny and I wrote about my books and I had made a funny book trailer, like a little mini movie for one of my books. So uh-huh. I included that. And the organizer called me mm-hmm. and said, we think you should apply to speak. Mm-hmm. And I put on my Wonder Woman bracelets and started deflecting. And I said, oh, no. See, I'm not a speaker. And they said, well, we think you're funny. Mm-hmm. And I said, thank you. I'm funny sitting down. I'm not funny standing up. I'm a sit-down comedian, you know. And they just kept pushing. And they said, well, first of all, the E in TED stands for entertainment.
Yeah.
And you're entertaining. And also, we're not saying you're going to get it. We're just saying you should apply. You uh-huh. should audition. And so then that was like, oh, you just threw down the gauntlet. Now I have to do this. And I did, uh-huh. and it wound up launching a whole new arm of my career that I never would have considered. I never uh-huh. would have had the nerve to say, I think I'm going to give a TED Talk. Mm-hmm. Never. I was going, no, I can't. I couldn't possibly. And it was the best thing I ever did.
And the arm of your career is now the speaking part.
Yeah.
Because you've never done that. Literally, that was your first public major.
My very first, which I do not recommend to anybody uh-huh. because, you know, I look back on it now and honestly, like, I cringe a little bit. Mm-hmm. I used to work for magazines, so I had formal media training. I used to go on talk shows and talk about various articles, mm-hmm. but never get up for 13 minutes straight with no cue cards and no notes and give my words. It was all me. And I look back on that now, and of course, because I've had all this practice, I've been flown around the country, spoke on a number of different topics. I wouldn't give that exact same talk today.
Sure.
But it worked for whatever reason. So, you know, if I could go back and change it, maybe I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing today. So mm-hmm. for whatever reason, that was meant to be, but
yeah, 4 million views is a lot.
A lot of people have seen it.
Yeah.
I have had talent agents calling me saying, oh, we really like it. I've gotten a few interviews for TV shows or looking for a host and they want someone in that space. And you know, that none of those have panned out yet, but just to be considered that it wouldn't even happen had I not done that. So
And so you said that launched a new wing of your career. Does that change your business model? Because I think about like the music industry. If you're a musician, it used to be that, you know, you would make an album and then you would sell albums and that's how you got paid. Nowadays, the album, like musicians don't make any money on albums. Right. Even if you're a Radiohead, you don't make money on albums. You make money on maybe Radiohead's a bad example because they're independent. But, you know, they don't make money on the albums. They make the money on the tours. So the album has become like almost like lead gen, right? It's like it's the way of getting it's your business card.
Exactly.
And people get into it and then they come to your shows and that's the business model.
So
what is that today for authors? Because, I mean, I think about, we're in a software as a service. So for us, it's a, people pay us every single month. Right. The idea of trying to get a customer and get $12 out of them one time for a book is like terrifying to me.
It's terrifying to me too.
Yeah. So
it's horrible. It's a horrible business model. And then they can return it if they don't like it, even if it's all dog-eared. Like, no, it's a terrible business model.
Yeah. So I almost can't even imagine how that works. So how does it work?
Well, it's part of that synergy mm-hmm. equation. So because when I go out to sell a book, so here's how it works. I write a book, I bring it to my agent. She says, yeah, it's great. Mm-hmm. Maybe after a revision or two, but ultimately, mm-hmm. yeah, it's great. Mm-hmm. Let's go bring it out to publishers. Part of that is she goes out with my platform. That's mm-hmm. it's your business plan for the book.
Yeah.
That includes Jenna's reach. It's how many people I can reach on social media, how many people I can get my physical body in front of, because people are very, very likely to buy your books if you're sitting there talking to them and they feel that connection with you, right? Yeah. Or a lot of times, I got smart after a few public speaking gigs and I said, hey, you should buy copies of my book and give them to all the attendees. They've never said no.
Yeah.
Right. So I go, oh, some missed opportunities there along the line. But so, you know, you wind up, you can ask for more money for an advance on your book. You may or may not earn it out, but you can ask for that because you can say, hey, look at all these people I can reach. But it also, it legitimizes you having the book when you go to speak. They, you know, when they introduce you as the author of blah, that people go, oh, she must know something. She wrote a book.
Right.
Then you have to back it up by actually knowing something.
Yeah.
But
so it does all work together,
yeah.
And you actually do pay the rent with book.
I do.
With book, what do they call it again?
Advances, royalties.
Yeah. Advances and speaking gigs.
Speaking gigs pay really well. That's a nice little.
So it's like the 1-2 punch.
Thing.
It's really great. Very interesting. So it's like old school, like back when you actually could make an album and sell the album for a living. That's kind of encouraging.
Most people aren't making a lot of money on books anymore. I think maybe not in the publishing world. We know this now. Uh-huh. We know this to be true. The days of the big advances, unless you're J.K. Rowling, they're basically gone.
Oh.
Because you have traditional publishers who are suddenly competing with the Amazons and the self-published.
Yeah.
And even if you've got this... Okay, I'll tell you a story of a friend. It was a very successful New York Times bestselling author. She had a book that had an editor change. Long story short, it came out and it didn't do as well as all of her other books. Water under the bridge, kind of a bummer, not the end of my career. I am a 7-time New York Times bestselling author.
Right.
She goes to turn in her next one and they say, we think, well, we're going to give you like a fraction of what we gave you before for your advance because we're not sure you can earn it out because that last one didn't sell so well. And also, we think you should change your name.
Start over.
Start, you know, just clean slate with one little dip on the, you know, EKG chart. All of a sudden she's, oh, you could be a pariah. I don't know. We're not sure, but we just a suggestion.
Wow.
And she basically said, bye-bye. I'm going to publish it myself. For a New York Times bestselling author to go self-pub after, you know, big Simon & Schuster, you know, top 6 publishers, people were like, oh, whoa, wow, okay. Like, I guess you can do that. I guess it's not a stigma anymore.
Uh-huh.
And she went on to make lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of money and have all the control and get her book to market quickly, whereas a traditional publisher would have taken 18 months to 2 years. So, you know, my whole industry is in crazy flux. It's nothing like it was when I started just 10 years ago.
Mm-hmm. And that's you know, I said Radiohead before, but that's actually exactly what they did. They had normal distribution and deals, and then they were like, forget that, and now they sell their album through their website. And I'm sure they're obviously doing that because they do way, way better.
Right. And there are bands that will probably say, oh, they couldn't get a record deal. And they're like, tell it to my accountant.
Right, yeah. They get to do that because they're Radiohead, because they have that, because they spent the time to build that that audience, right? And people will show up for that. So interesting. So tell me then, what is like next for you? What are you learning? What is the kind of cutting edge for you?
I don't know if it's cutting edge. I would call it more insane, probably, because if the only thing that might be harder to do than be super successful in traditional publishing would be to be super successful in screenwriting.
Uh-huh.
But I sold the TV rights to one of my books a while back. And there was kind of this back and forth, and they couldn't find the right writer to put on it. And so I thought, well, I should know how to do that, right? I should know how to screenwrite. And I had all these people telling me, it's nothing like writing a book. And, you know, I always come back to when my husband and I first had children and we'd get overwhelmed, we had a little motto that we lived by that would get us through the tough times. And it's really profound. It was dumber people than us do this.
Right.
Dumber people than us do this. I'm a pretty sharp cat. I know about writing. If I can read a book on screenwriting and I can understand what the parameters are. So I did a little test and I bought the software and I taught myself and I wrote an original screenplay. And just for fun, I submitted it to the Austin Film Festival. It didn't win, but it made it to the final round.
Wow.
And so I thought, okay, I mean, tens of thousands of submissions, I think. There were in the multiple thousands. So I was like, all right, that's something I can do. So I have a really good idea for the next one. I might try to polish that one and resubmit it, but I have one that I seriously am obsessed with that I want to write.
Uh-huh. And so this is now more like a wild lottery ticket, right? Like you write these and you write these and you write these, and then one of them gets picked up and you make a lot of money from one of these.
Yeah, no, so, it's insane. Like there are people who have been living in Hollywood mm-hmm. for 40 years who have done nothing but this, and they've studied with the masters and they do it all day, every day. And it's no different than a struggling musician that you hear in some dive bar and you think, why is she not famous? Yeah. She's so good. And she's like, I'm trying.
Yeah.
I don't know. You know, there's so much talent in the world. And there's so much non-talent. I mean, I'm just being honest that it's hard to stand out in any way, but you know, what are you learning? I'm learning that dumber people than me do this.
Yeah, Marie Forleo says was one of our clients, and she's kind of famous for saying that everything is figure outable, and it's the same thing, right? Yeah. You can kind of like if somebody's done it before me, then it's got to be doable,
right? Might not be easy, it might not be fun, mm-hmm. but it's doable.
And it seems like you're the foundation that you built with your speaking and your you know traditional book writing career has given you like the opportunity to take this kind of risk without, you know, kind of like waiting tables at night, right?
Right. It's the only thing I'm risking is my time. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, people say, how do you have time to do all that? And I said, mm-hmm. well, I mean, I don't watch any TV. Mm-hmm. I make my choices, and mm-hmm. my vice is I want to write.
Yeah.
And I want to be able to, you know, I have to, like I said, I have to pay the bills. So I have to spend a certain amount of my energy on paying assignments, and I will still take random magazine things just like, oh, that'll be a nice chunk of change I can earn in a couple of days, and then that buys me some freedom to, you know, go do something that I want to do.
Yeah. So amazing. It's not that many people that I think, you know, compared to the number of people that would like to support themselves, especially in Santa Barbara, by writing, there's got to be very few that actually pull that off.
I'm old, though, so I've been doing it for a really long time. Okay, it doesn't happen overnight.
Yeah, I mean, that's interesting. I mean, without giving anything away, I mean, how long has it taken you from like the early days of going like, I think I'm going to be a writer, and here's my first manuscript to kind of like the point where you're like, yeah, I'm actually supporting myself as a writer.
I got really lucky. So backtrack into my mid-20s, mm-hmm. I was working in an advertising agency, and I got laid off. It was actually on my 25th birthday, mm-hmm. and I showed up. You'll like this story. I showed up, and there was all these cops in the lobby, and I was like, what's going on? And one of my friends is like, and we lost our big client. They're laying off 75% of the staff. And I'm not, as God is my witness, I thought, didn't even occur to me that I might be one of them. I was like, oh, that would suck to lose your job. But it's my birthday. I'm going out tonight. And I get to my office and all my stuff is being packed up. And I'm like, wait, why? Okay. Wow. I don't really know what to do with that. And so I stole a stapler and some sticky notes and I went home and I called my dad and I go, what do you do when you get laid off? I don't really know what this looks like. And he's like, well, you go to the unemployment office. So I did that once mm-hmm. with all the homeless people. And I was like, no, I'm just going to get a job. I think I'll just go find a job. Mm-hmm. So, I started freelance writing and I was in the advertising world. So I was doing really creative, you know, bank brochures and that mm-hmm. type of thing.
Yeah.
And then I thought again, dumber people than me do this. I was like, I should like write for some big magazines. I should just start submitting willy-nilly stories that I think are interesting.
Yeah.
Which is so not how you do it. Uh-huh. It's, you know, I've given talks at multiple colleges. So you want to write for magazines? Here's what not to do. Uh-huh. But it worked for me. So don't ever listen to anybody when they tell you what not to do. Uh-huh. So I'm sending these unsolicited manuscripts off to New York and mm-hmm. I get a phone call, because it wasn't even computers. I was still on a typewriter back then. Oh, wow. I got a phone call from a lady who was like 22, who became my boss, who said, I really like this. I can't buy it or publish it, but I'm hiring writers and I would love to interview you. And I said, okay, I was in Florida at the time. She's like, I can't fly you up. I have 200 people I'm seeing from New York, but if you'll get yourself up here, I'd love to just sit down with you. So I flew myself to New York and we sat just like this. And she's like, okay, great, you're hired. And I was like, that's awesome, thanks. And I got back to my hotel and I called my parents and they were like, oh my God, like how much money are you making? What's it? I'm like, oh, I forgot to ask that.
Yeah.
No idea. I don't even know what my title is, but it's 17 magazine. I start in 2 weeks.
Wow.
So I went home and packed up all my stuff and moved to New York. And again, dumber people than me.
Mm-hmm. And so that was it.
That worked.
And
it worked for me.
So if you could go back to those early days, and give yourself a piece of advice, or say somebody today that was, starting off, what would that advice be?
Oh, sweet little naive Jenna. What would I tell her? I would tell her so much. I would have to sit her down for like weeks because she was going to make some big mistakes. I think the two things I would tell her are, in all honesty, stay dumb. Uh-huh. Stay a little bit dumb. Uh-huh. Stay dumb enough that you're not afraid to try these things that any sane person, any smart person mm-hmm. would tell you, that's out of your league, dude. Mm-hmm. Like, that's out of your league. You're not, I got to 17 Magazine and these girls would say like, oh, whose shirt is that? And I'd be like, it's mine. Like, are you all wearing somebody else's clothes? I don't get it. So they meant, is it Ralph Lauren? Right. I don't know. It's mine. And everyone would laugh. And I'm like, oh, they think I'm so funny. I have no idea what they're talking about. So that would be good advice. Be dumb. Don't be afraid to apply for a TED Talk and do it. Dumber people than you do it. Don't be afraid to write a book, publish it yourself. Try all these things. And the other thing I would tell little Jenna is, never say never. Never say never. I'm not going to give a talk. I'm not a speaker. I've kind of learned since then. That was kind of a really pivotal moment for me, giving that speech. And I woke up and I said, you know what? From now on, the answer to anything is yes until it makes sense to say no. Hey, do you want to come speak to our group in Kansas City? Yes. Right. Tell me some more details about that. Before I'm like, oh, I don't know, Kansas City, I've never, is that a good market? Yes. Just keep, yes, until they say, and we want you to wear a goat suit and, roll around on the stage. That's a good reason to say no. I'm gonna say no then.
Yeah.
But until then, it's yes.
Yeah, I agree. I think back to some of the things that I did in the early days of this business that, that today I would never do and would look like a ridiculous waste of time.
But they worked.
But those were the things. I mean, some worked, some didn't, some were a waste of time. But little by little, you learn, and also, this relationship gets made and that relationship gets made. And,
right.
I actually just had this guy email me the other just yesterday asking me about this ad, or a letter, actually, like a sales brochure, I guess, that I had written that he remembered from like 10, 12 years ago. And he wanted a copy of it because he was like, it was the greatest ad I've ever seen. I think it's when you launched your business and I want to do something similar. I was like, I can't even remember what you're talking about. But I actually went back to like this old bunch of files, and I actually didn't find it, but I found something that was from the similar era, and it's kind of incredible to go back and look and go, you know what, this, I can't even believe it. I remember this event that I went to, and there's like 16 people there. I spent way too much money on it. Like, I hauled my ass all the way out to like, South Georgia for this thing. Like, there's no way I would do that today. But then I think back and I go like, oh wait, I met that guy and he introduced me to that guy, and that turned into a deal that I think since then has actually earned our business like $3 million.
Oh my gosh. Yeah.
And so you just never know what happens when you say yes to random stuff.
I'm picturing Justin Bieber in the movie, in the parking lot, in the tent, in the rain, like at the grocery store grand opening. Like, you're paying your dues, right?
Yeah. Did he do that?
Sometimes they work. He did.
Oh, wow.
I totally cried. I have a teenage daughter, so you watch these things.
There's a video of it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. The movie.
Oh,
The Justin Bieber movie.
Sorry, I don't know.
Oh, it's good. It is good.
So
I'll regret I said that on camera, but it's good. I cried.
Okay, good. I'll check it out. So what would you like your legacy to be, do you think?
Well, I am a mom. Mm-hmm. Above and before all else, that is the truth. And, I think about, I have two daughters, they're 12 and 14, and they are somehow still living in a world where men are making more money than women, and a lot of women, most women that I know, at some point and to some degree, are forced to choose between career and family.
Mm-hmm.
And I grew up with a dad who was an entrepreneur, and he used to say to me, I would say, what am I going to do when I grow up? And he would say, I don't care. but don't work for anyone else. Whatever you do, don't work for anyone else. Mm-hmm. And he made it very clear that that would be miserable. And, mm-hmm. you know, I'm sure you're lovely to work for. I'm not talking to your employees, but everyone else, don't work for anyone else. Mm-hmm. And so I'm raising my daughters with that. I want them to know that in their being mm-hmm. that they can have it all. Mm-hmm. They can't have it all. They might not be able to have it all every minute of every day, but they can have the career and drive on the field trips and volunteer in the classrooms. And, you know, they might be up all night in order to do that. And mm-hmm. they might be, you know, working early in the morning, but you can have that and nobody can tell you that you can't.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. To be remembered by your daughters.
Yeah.
Two daughters.
Yeah.
For having kind of like instilled that perspective that gives them those opportunities.
God willing. And also I would like one day for one person to Google Jenny McCarthy and have it say, did you mean Jenna McCarthy? That would be an awesome legacy too. Those two things, good modeling for my daughters and the Jenny McCarthy thing.
Very nice. Yeah. So what do you think it means to be a modern entrepreneur?
Well, the first thing that comes to mind when I saw this and saw that was the name of the series, I thought about my dad, who is no longer with us, but was the first entrepreneur I ever knew mm-hmm. and my hero. And I thought, what made him an entrepreneur? And in his day, as opposed to being modern, it was he had an idea and he had the guts to do it and to go for it and to execute it and to do it better than anyone else. Mm-hmm. That's all he had to do back then.
Yeah.
And so I'm comparing myself, what, you know, do I write better than anyone else in the world? Probably not. So what is it that makes the modern entrepreneur is the ability to evolve. You have to keep evolving. You know, I talk to people and they say, well, you know, I have a website and I have a social media presence. It's mm-hmm. like, yeah, is your website mobile optimized? Mm-hmm. And is your MySpace page your social media presence? Mm-hmm. Like you can't go, I don't really like the technology and I don't really, if you want to be a modern entrepreneur, you better be up with all of that. And mm-hmm. you have to find a way to be at least a little bit passionate about it or surround yourself with people who are, or companies like Ontraport mm-hmm. that can bring you into that, because that is what it means to me, to be modern, to be evolving, to be keeping up, to be, you know, walking the walk and doing it at the same time.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for being here. Would you mind signing our, what is that? A sign?
I would love to sign your sign.
All right. Thanks.
We have some strategies in place to make sure that we're always hiring A people. For example, on the engineering side, one of the practices we have is if we have 5-6 people interview someone, we have kind of a single veto policy. So if one person doesn't like that person and everyone else loves them, mm-hmm. we will pass on that candidate. And sometimes we pass on really good candidates based on that, but it really keeps the bar high.